If you are a fan of the history of motorcycle drag racing, this video is gold. Stay with us because Top Fuel legend Larry Spiderman McBride is going to take us back in time where we see legends like Elmer Trett, Jim McClure, and more. We're going back to ATCO 1991. This is a shot of Larry McBride today. He has clearly made his mentors proud. Welcome, Cycledrag. It is a brand new segment called Watching VHS with Legends. This is ATCO, New Jersey, in the Philadelphia area. Quick history about this race. During the 70s, 80s, and early 90s, this was the biggest and baddest motorcycle drag race in the world. It was huge. That's my family right there. If it wasn't for these beloved guys, my father and my godfather, bringing me over from Pittsburgh because this is a race that they had followed for so many years, this channel may not be here. That's how awesome this race was. But we're going to see some true motorcycle legends. We're going to take a trip down history lane. Stay with us in this video. The only thing that's missing is if I had a legend to talk about this great video with. If only I had a legend sitting right, wait a minute, Larry Spider-Man McBride in my living room. What the heck are you doing here?
Man, watching VHS, man, ATCO 1991. So just excited and getting ready to go to the Supercross here in a little bit.
Yeah, this is a good opportunity. We got to get the Supercross, but I had to sit you down and show you some of this classic old footage. Right off the bat, what do you remember about ATCO? This race was, it was the biggest thing going.
Well, it was the U.S. Nationals. You know, it was kind of like our world finals are. And Scooter did a heck of a job. This was back in the Prostar days. So it was a great, great race. And really missed the U.S. Nationals. That's when all the Europeans used to come. You know, Brian Johnson used to come over. It's a race that we missed dearly.
It was appropriately named because Scooter Kizer, who you mentioned, he was the leader of AMA ProStar. This was year number three for ProStar. This race was contested under several different organizations. And one thing that I laugh at that we saw right away is not too many motorhomes. There were a lot of vans back then, weren't there?
I'm talking about a lot of vans. You had to have a van. I tell you, I had a big trailer back then. I had a 16-foot trailer, and it was awesome. I need to go back to that. A lot easier to load up and unload. So, putting up easy ups was easy. So, I do miss them days. It was a great, great, great days. But, time goes on, so we just have to deal with everything.
We traveled in from Pittsburgh, and we knew that we would always see the big names. We loved to get there. The excitement we would feel walking around the pits was bar none. Scooter Kaiser told me the reason this was called the U.S. Nationals is because it was motorcycle drag racing's version of NHRA's U.S. Nationals. You want to talk about a legend? Larry, there he is right there. A young
Bill Furr
and Southern Rock. That is a beautiful motorcycle that Armin says he may restore and it may go in the
hole. Notice the good part about back then? Did you see how they could use gloves, his gloves, for different things? His gloves is now an injector cover. So, not only do you have to wear the gloves, they double as an injector.
Now, how about this beautiful motorcycle you know well? And we got to tag Todd Leatherman because he currently owns it and competes in the dirt. But that's the lovely Trudy and the lovely Ron Webb.
That was one pretty motorcycle right there. And we miss Ron and Trudy and Big Carl so much. It was a great part of my racing career. And like I said, I do get to see Ron. He usually comes to the world finals. Unfortunately, this year we didn't see him. I'm thinking there must have been a boat race somewhere because he was really into boat racing. So we do miss him, but there were some great days right there.
What a woman Trudy is. Look at her windexing and polishing that bike from top to bottom.
She used to keep that thing spotless.
It's hard to believe that motorcycle is actually out in the dirt right now doing some sand dragging. We'll have to check that out. And hey, wait a minute. Whose motorcycle is that one right there?
Well, that's the one that I purchased from Terry Vance back in 1985. So you got to realize that's 6 years later, so the bike transformed. And now we got Brian Johnson's bike coming up right now. That's another beautiful motorcycle. It's actually ahead of its day. And, that chassis was also built by Puppet. So the chassis, the body, and you know, Brian did all the other work to the motorcycle, all his motor plates and things like that. So
he is a late great legend. I was so honored to go over to England and do his Hall of Fame speech, and we were talking about this earlier on. If you look at how clean and immaculate and professional that motorcycle is, isn't it hard to believe he put it together in a shed?
Yeah, I know, that's what we was talking about earlier. In a shed, unbelievable.
Oh, and here's something truly special. This is one of the individuals that made both of our Mount Rushmores, one of the four greatest of all time. This is the godfather of Nitro Harley, the judge, Jim McClure. And if you watch closely, who's coming over to talk to Jim McClure with those big old blue pants?
Well, that was me in the younger days. I tell you, I really miss them days. You know, Jim was a very dear friend of mine, just lived right up the road from me. And, you know, for years and years, his shop was only, you know, two blocks from me, so from my shop. So Jim and I, we got along great. And back in the day before I had honing machines and welders and all that, Jim used to do all my welding, all my honing, and basically was a big part of teaching me how to weld. And a great ambassador of our sport. And I was so sad the day that that Jim passed away. And I was right there going and seeing him all the time when he was in the hospital sick. And it was just a shame to see him go, because he was a great innovator in Harley drag racing.
We miss him. Look at the speaking of somebody we miss, Take a look at this beautiful motorcycle. Larry, give me a tour of what we're looking at.
Well, right now, that is Mountain Magic right there, and that's the bike that Tommy Smith bought from Elmer. And
look at how gorgeous it is. It's everything is perfect.
Everything is always perfect on Elmer's bikes, and you know, that's who we got to spend a lot of our time with, between Elmer and Jim, and how perfect all their stuff was. It made us better and better and better, and it was just awesome years back then, just awesome, awesome.
Elmer was so far ahead of his time, so dearly missed. That's a motorcycle that hopefully ends up in a museum someday. And is that the great Jack O'Malley that we see right there?
That's exactly who that is. That's Jack O'Malley himself. So, you know, another great guy in the motorcycle racing business that, you know, that passed away at, and I believe he passed away at his shop.
And I got to thank my godfather for taking this VHS. You know, he just got this camcorder in 91. If you had a camcorder in 91, you were the man. We tried to figure out who this was on this Harley, and Larry, you believe that this is none other than Jay Turner Racing's...
Mark Connor, and I believe this is the bike that Mark rode. I'm not 100% sure. Now, I know that he rode, I cannot think of the tuner's name there right off. He's a great guy. But Mark did ride for him, but I'm pretty sure this is the bike that Mark Connor rode. I'm almost 100% sure.
Well, there's definitely some legends that we see here, and I know my memories are a little bit hazy, but I'll tell you, the personal connection I had to this race, it was like going to the amusement park. It was like Christmas. I had so much fun. I fell in love with this sport, sitting up in the grandstands, watching all these legends. You guys really knew how to put on a show, and when we see the stands, I mean, the turnout was crazy. Here's something I want to talk about. Here's another guy on my Mount Rushmore, two guys on my Mount Rushmore. First off, Dave Schultz. Look at this rig. Totally immaculate. Totally ahead of his time. And something that I think's cool, does anyone know who is doing an interview with Dave Schultz right there, sitting on that gorgeous Eagle One Vance and Hines motorcycle? If you said, ding, 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 AMA ProStar Scooter Kizer, you are correct. Larry, this is why Scooter made my Mount Rushmore. Even back then, Scooter understanding the importance of exposure and TV.
Absolutely, and that's the things that a promoter should be doing. You know, Scooter didn't have the resources to hire another person to come out and do the interview. So look at there, he's out doing them himself. And, you know, Scooter used to do all the voiceovers on the racing also. So, you know, Gainesville stuff, he'd go and do all the voiceover stuff. So
great coat.
Great coat coming out of the trailer there. Another great superstar in pro stock motorcycle drag racing, cylinder heads and things like that.
My godfather getting a shot of that little mini bike, because I think I begged my father endlessly for one of those, much like your grandson would probably beg you right now for that thing.
Oh, absolutely. So,
speaking of the Kizer family, there's a funny bike legend, Terry Kizer. That was a special motorcycle for Orient Express.
Oh, yes, it was. And he won a lot of races, too. So,
and back then, you lined up with Terry several times, didn't you?
Oh, geez. Yeah, we've had some heck of a heck of a rivalry right there between Terry and I. And, you know, Terry had a, on the body, he had a supercharged with an X drawn through it, right? So I put a a hair dryer on mine and drawed an X through it. And, you know, when I won that year there, we actually took and put two hair dryers on the motorcycle, two blow dryers, and went up there to take the picture. So it was pretty awesome.
Isn't that something? And we all lived through this era. I'm so fortunate that we lived through these races. Oh, man, there I am giving the bunny ears right there, misbehaving. That is a young shot of Cycledrag. 7 years old. God bless my dad's buddies. That's my dad on the left. Our good friend Mole, who unfortunately passed away. The man in the camo hat passed away. We just loved sitting in. Look at the stands. It's a cold October day, and ATCO was filled. There was so much passion.
Well, the race hadn't even started at this point. When this race really gets going here, this is still early morning, so the stands get a whole lot more filled. But you know, what's more than anything is the fence line that was filled all the way to top end, and all the people cooking out. And I used to slip away from the pits and go down there and grab stuff to eat from different people. So it was pretty awesome.
You knew all the tricks even back then. And how about all these years later, did you ever think this would be the track that you suffered one of the nastiest incidents of your career at? This is where blew up.
Exactly. In 2015, it's hard to believe that you know, that we're actually going on 5 years that happened. Seems like it was yesterday. But you know, it was a great track. No fault of the track, of course, but it was just a place that it happened at, and I missed racing there dearly.
And how about what it used to take? We just watched the GS run 10.01. What I was laughing with you about is what a GSXR 1000 or a Hayabusa can do bone stock. Now, how much money did you have to put into a GS with parts to go 10.01?
Well, you got to realize that was a motorcycle back then that came from the factory with less than 100 horsepower. We have 600s today coming from the factory with over 100 horsepower. So you're looking at a Hayabusa that's, you know, well, I don't know exactly what a stock Hayabusa is, but I think it's 180 horsepower or something like that.
Sure.
190 horsepower. And I mean, you can go well over 200 horsepower by just putting a, you know, a Brock's Performance, Vance and Hines, a tuner on it. And, you know, you can go out there and run, as a rookie, you can run 970s. As you know, that's what you did. So that's what you can do today. Well, that's what we have to work with today.
Such a great time. Look at all the trailers too, and how professional the Midway was. All the old school cars. This was a happening. People came from far and wide for the U.S. Nationals at beautiful ATCO, New Jersey. If you ever attended this race, let us know. If you have any stories from ATCO or from back in the day, please leave them in the comments. It was always something special when you saw it. John Myers in the Star trailer, Dave Schultz in the Snowco trailer, Larry McBride, Elmer Trett, Jim McClure. You saw those guys, you knew you were in for one heck of a good show at ATCO, New Jersey.
Oh, days, man. I tell you, them, you sit here and watch this, and it just brings so many memories back. And miss them days, unfortunately. They're not going to come back, but it sure don't hurt to watch these old VHS tapes every now and then. And glad to see you still got a
VCR. Yeah, I may be the only guy over here with a VCR.
No, I still have one at the shop because I got a lot of VHS tapes. As you know, I sent a bunch to you that you've only sent me part of them back.
And I think so, you told me, I think the deal was if I lose them, you're going to kill me.
Right? Absolutely. You won't ever have to worry about ever losing anything else again. And we can actually do away with Cycledrag.
There's a couple of people that would be happy with that.
I was thinking the same thing. I just didn't say it. would you like me to name them?
That's okay. We better not go there. Here's something I want to talk about that we just saw on the starting line. And this speaks to the professionalism of Scooter Kizer. Two guys on the starting line with crew hats on, crew shirts, guy in the burnout box. Let me see if we go back to that shot, if I can show you what I mean right here. The old 920 class. That was back when, before our 890, there was 920. Look at the guys on the starting line, though. You had a starter. You had a starter's helper. You had a guy back in staging. It was a first-class operation with Scooter. He was staffed.
No question about it. He run a top-notch organization. And, you know, unfortunately, them days are gone. I mean, there's definitely some top-notch people out there and, that's running some, you know, top-notch stuff right now. So I'm glad to see us coming back, and it's something our sport needs. I mean, we, you know, our sport hurt desperately back in 2008 through 2009. It took a while to really rebuild it. And I think right now we got a real, our sport's real healthy right now, as the World Final showed how healthy it really was. And as the XDA races show how healthy it is, and the Man Cup races, and of course the NHDRO, we have a healthy sport.
Sure.
Unfortunately, the thing that we see today is the people, even though our sport's healthy, with all the, you know, with the organizations, people just don't travel like we used to back then.
Yes.
Of course, now
gas was what, 79 cents back then.
Yeah, exactly, and cheaper. So, you know, where today it's a lot more expensive, and in the races, you know, back in the day, you know, we, you know, only our World Finals and things like that were 3-day races. Now a lot of times, you know, now the races are all 3-day. All the equipment's so high tech today, you actually got to go out and get some test runs and get the bike down the track. That's how important it is today. The setups of the bikes are so important to do, and that's the thing we have to look at today. We get there, you know, we leave now on Tuesday or Wednesday to go to a race, and we take a week off.
Week off. Hey, speaking of XDA, what's great, this is the greatest market in motorcycle drag racing, if you ask me, the Philadelphia area, the Northeast. That's Jimmy Shifflett, left-hand lane, the Hillbilly Hustler. He's still out there with Rob Honeycutt, Mac McAdams, and his whole crew. A lot of these guys we're watching on this tape still run XDA.
Oh, exactly. Cup. And that's another thing that we... Our sport's getting old.
It so, sure is.
Not only in Top Fuel, but in all the classes. So we need some new young guys out there.
It was a lot of fun, and it took a lot of money to go 920s, that's for sure. All kind of beautiful motorcycles. What's your best memory from ATCO, if you had to pinpoint one? I know it's not 2014, well, 2015.
Well, the best memory is, you know, I set my first record there, 6:49.
At this race?
At this race, 1991.
Isn't that crazy? October 6th it was on this particular day. ATCO used to get a little chilly.
Oh, yeah, it was basically extra chilly that weekend. So you made great horsepower. Matter of fact, it was so chilly. And, you know, back in the day, just to give you a reference, in today's world, we run a 21-gallon fuel pump. Back in them days there, we run a 6-gallon fuel pump.
Oh, my gosh.
We burn approximately 1 to maybe 1.5 gallons of fuel from start up to the end of the run. We're burning 4.5 to 5 gallons.
That's
this
insane.
Day and time. And there, the air was so cool, we didn't know what in the world can we do to give this thing more fuel. We can't, we're out of jets. We've done everything we can do. And I used to deal with a guy named Art Whipple that owns Whipple Superchargers out in California. And I actually called him on, I think it was Saturday night. And I told him, I said, man, the weather's cold. My main jets are, I actually got them blocked off, and the thing's still wanting more fuel. He said, well, there's only one other choice, speed the fuel pump up. Have you got any way to do that? And I said, you know, actually I do have a smaller pulley. So we went in there, got the smaller pulley, put the smaller pulley on there, drilled a hole in the frigging motor plate. Steve tapped it. We put a long bolt in there, a bearing on there as the belt idler, because we had to tighten the belt up because it changed our center distance on the belt. So now it's no longer tight. Oh, so we did all that offhand, put that on there, and went out there the very next pass and went 6:49 at 2:14. Then at ATCO's famous deal, it gets rained out.
Yeah, there were a lot of rain outs back then.
We didn't call the race and race it at the next race. You stayed over and raced on Monday. So we stayed over, raced on Monday with a sleepless night, thinking about what's going to happen. We go out there and we run. And if I recall properly, I think Elmer and I made our pass around 9:30 in the morning.
Oh, my gosh.
So it was still pretty freaking cold.
Sure.
We went right back out there and went 6:49. And I believe I run 2:13. So we ended up with the ET record and we won the race. Then the next day was, and that was the world, that was the U.S. Nationals. we actually had our banquet the next morning. They tried to have the banquet then to keep from everybody traveling and trying to, you know, just save everybody as much money as they could. And we went back, and our class was actually sponsored by EBC Brakes back then. And I got a $10,000 for winning.
$10,000. Hold that thought for 1 second, because I want to show you somebody. Speaking of Top Fuel, we got to give a shout out to our main man. There's a two-stroke in the left lane, a Yamaha FJ in the right lane. Who knows who this is? Any idea? In the comments. Top Fuel's a clue. Would you believe me if I told you near lane, black Yamaha, Larry, that's your good buddy, your rival, Dave Vantine. A young Dave Vantine getting it done.
The Iron Man.
The Iron Man. Yes, we may see Dave Vantine become the Iron Man.
No, he is the Iron Man.
He is the Iron Man. He's awesome. What a talent. 930. That's why he's making Top Fuel look easy, because he has so many laps. But getting back to what you said, holding that thought, $10,000 you won in 1991. How were there bigger payouts back then than there are now? How did that happen?
You know, I don't have an answer. All I can tell you is...
Because now for winning the championship, you get...
Scooter kind of...
What do you get now?
The championship?
Yes.
We get a plaque.
A plaque and...
Oh, and we get man cup bucks. I mean...
Which you can use for
man cup... We can buy stuff there. We can buy tickets. We can do...
Merchandise.
But it just goes to show you...
What do you get about...
Our sport is never recovered, I don't think. I mean... Scooter worked extremely hard with the factories, and he went to people like EBC Brakes and Primo Belt Drives and all these people to get money for the championship stuff, you know, APE, you know, all the contingency money. You know, I used to win in contingency money. We would win as much money in contingency monies as we did in personally. So on an average race back in the day, you know, we would win anywhere from $2,500 to $3,000 in contingency money. And back then in 1991, I believe the purse of this particular race was $3,500.
Oh,
believe.
Wow. In 91.
In 1991.
So I mean, if you use the formula to figure out what money was worth back then, I gotta believe, I mean, that's gotta be more than double since 1991, right?
Oh, there's no question about it. Absolutely no question.
Wow.
It was great. And then the championship money that you won, and the beautiful pyramid that Scooter used to give you for your, for the points thing was a great, great deal.
How do we get back there?
I don't know how. I don't know what the answer is. Unfortunately, I am a racer, not a promoter. You got to have the foresight. But you know what? The pyramids and the trophies and the Wallys, you know, in NHRA, that's what at the end of the year means. Is that something special? And it's kind of like George was saying the other night, winning a Wally with Vance and Hines and them guys. That Vance and Hines made it mean so much more to be able to win a Wally, because they're so hard of a team to beat.
Sure.
And it's same thing back then, you know, with, you know, racing Elmer and all that. I mean, Elmer made us work 10 times as hard.
Well, I'm sure you beat Elmer Trett. So you earned it, didn't you?
You definitely earned it. And I tell you right now, there was few far in between, because he used to spank this little boy's butt here all the time. So, and I had all the respect in the world, because I was just steady. We was just steady trying to soak up information and learn and try to get on the same level with him. And we got to go down to his house in Georgia and spend a lot of time, with him at the shop and, stay at the house. And, you know, he used to put me in the basement, and it was kind of crazy how he used to treat me. You know, he said he'd put me in the basement, and, all his trophies were in the basement.
Oh, it must have been a big basement.
And I asked him, so why do you put me down here? He said, I don't want you to forget who number one is. So it was always awesome. That's just the kind of person that Elmer was. Always joking, always trying to stay ahead of you.
Well, that was probably a good way to motivate you. And speaking of, here's somebody who Scooter Kizer called England's Elmer Trett, Brian Johnson. He truly was a legend over there for sure.
Oh, no question about it. Brian was definitely a legend and a dear friend at the same time.
What do you remember about this particular bike, Larry?
I remember the best thing I remember that bike right there. I got to race the whole lot, and you know, Brian actually sold that bike to Jimmy Brantley.
Is that the same one that he sold? So that was Jimmy Brantley's first top fuel bike.
That was Jimmy's first top fuel bike, and then Jimmy sold it to somebody else. They came from overseas and bought it.
Wow. And what I want you to do is pay attention to the stands, guys. This is a chilly Saturday. This is qualifying. Stands are packed on the other side. Guess what? The more crowded side is the one that we're on right now. So wait till you see when my godfather tries to get some of these times. He gets lost in a sea of heads, but it's a great market. It was close to the Philadelphia area. So many motorcycle fans there, but you know, oh, and there's the great Terry Kizer. You just don't see those type of fan turnouts much anymore, do you?
No, not like you used to back then. You know, like I was telling you earlier, back in the, you know, the Gainesville World Final days, back in them days, I would have, you know, people lined up for autographs. It seemed like for a mile long, it was crazy. Miss them days, we miss all of the people.
And I think part of what set Scooter apart is his brother was a legend. There's his brother right there, Terry Kizer. He knew the sport inside and out from his brother being such a competitor. And we might as well mention this too, because I think before we even bring it up, there's probably already a comment from our friend Walt Timblin, because right now he sees a turbo bike up against a top fuel bike. They used to do it that way, and you guys have talked about maybe bringing that back. What do you think of when you see this old matchup, turbo versus top fuel?
Oh, it brings back the good old days, but you know, I tell you what stuck in our head, Joe, is Elmer's the one that got everybody rousted about the Nitro rule, so about the 50% minimum rule. So,
wow, great pass, Brian. I'm sorry we lose you in the sea of heads here. Wasn't easy to run a camcorder back in 91, let me tell you. 681, 20, is it 20? 178 for Terry Cox. 208 in 1991.
Right, the only reason you didn't see them going faster, if you listen to the bike, is just driving right slam through the clutch. So the clutch technology was definitely not there. So,
and I told you too how much I love that wall at ADCO that helped keep noise down. It also made the burnout sound even better. I think nothing sounded quite like a burnout in ADCO. And who's coming up next, Larry?
The days of the rolling burnout right there. I tell you, I started doing rolling burnouts in 1991. So there's some people that do them today and say, oh, we innovated them. Well, right here's the proof that I was doing them in 91.
Now, who is that pushing you back? Is that Johnny?
That was Johnny Colbert.
And Steve is getting ready. Steve's probably over at the 330 right now?
Yeah, Steve's somewhere around. I don't want to worry that right now, but he's out there probably waiting to push me back or something. And I think on this particular run here, I don't even roll no smoke. I think this is the one, if I remember it correctly. Yeah. It didn't even roll on the smoke, but, you know, it didn't really matter.
So why again the rolling burnout?
Well, that's just the way we started doing it. I don't really have an answer for you. And this is Jim Magnus right here. This bike right here was actually a two-stroke.
Wow.
It's got a head on it, the way he designed everything. If you could get a close up where the exhaust pipes come out, which you can't see.
Unfortunately, we don't have HD here, but
yeah, it's the exhaust pipes actually coming out of the cylinder, not out of the head. He turned that into a two-stroke on nitro. It was pretty impressive piece of engineering.
What's impressive to me is I did the math. At this point, you were 33 years old. Correct. You've always seemed so much older to me just because you're a legendary guy. You've done so much. You've had a long career. But I'm thinking you were younger than I am at this point. And in this day and age, you really don't see too many 33-year-old men in top fuel motorcycle, do you?
No, you don't. It's a shame. We're hoping that our sport, that we're going to get some people to come back in and, you know, keep top fuel going. But if they don't, I've had a great run, and I'll still support motorcycle drag racing because I still love all the new bikes that are out there, all the pro street stuff, and all the nitrous bikes, you know.
Well, you just hit on something. You know, we talk about how top fuel is declining and people are getting older, but you see a class like pro street, and you do see a lot of young men. That's where the young men are now.
Absolutely, and I tell you, if you look at top fuel Harley, they got the same problem. So,
that's another deal right there. You don't see the young happy rings that's 18 years old out there no more.
That's right. Looks like Jim Mangus shut it off here. Were you taking too long there, Larry? Did you take too long?
No. That was just one of them things back then. Things were a little slow. I mean, I've been accused of being a little slow, but what people have to do, what I do, is you have to watch your competitors, how much time they take. Nobody says you got to crank up when they do. So you got to do just like NHRA does. You see some top fuelers that go out there and do their burnout. You see other guys don't even start doing his burnout or do anything. So the guy's almost back at the tree. So I suggest that people watch what their competitors do and write it down in their book so they know who they're dealing with.
How about a 668, 208 back then? That motorcycle looked like it was a handful.
It was. Back in the day, it was a handful, but still a lot of fun at the same time. So I don't miss them days. I miss them days, but I don't miss them handling days because the bikes we have today handle so much better.
And that bike, all these years later, is now back in your Virginia shop, isn't it?
Actually, it's at Roland's shop right now in
Gainesville,
Florida. Well, we're actually going to bring it back to the shop. Unfortunately, we're not going to be able to get it. We thought we could put it back together 100%, but unfortunately, while it was at
Sam Wills.
A bunch of parts got missing.
Oh. And
unfortunately, that's just something we have to deal with. And you know, I'm not trying to hold any grudges on anybody, but I can't, it's probably my fault for...
Yeah, God only knows what happened in a shop in 30 years,
well,
right?
It was 20 years. It was at Sam's. I probably should have stayed on Sam to maybe get it done. Shouldn't have waited too long. But, you know, unfortunately, that's what we did. And there's no sense in living in the past. You know, all we can do is try to, you know, keep looking for our parts. And if anybody ever comes out with them, we'll know exactly where they are. In the vintage world, the transmissions basically, they don't even make them no more, so we'd know it immediately, and everything's marked. And so whoever got that stuff out there and they see this deal, don't show up at the racetrack with it.
Please give them back. We'll take them back.
Don't try to put it in another vintage motorcycle and put it in a museum, because we'll find it. And it's just sad that that's the way things had to go. And unfortunately, Sam don't know what happened to the parts, how somebody can go into your shop and get that many parts off of a motorcycle without knowing about it. Down to me. I just don't know. I don't operate my business like that, but unfortunately, Sam's a very dear friend of mine, and I believe everything he said. He had a lot of people in and out of his shop a good day, so Sam was a very busy man, building stuff for lunch counter choppers and things like that, so he wasn't really worried about stuff that was upstairs.
Sure.
So I think Sam's such a good guy. I mean, I'm thinking people took advantage of him.
Could have happened, unfortunately.
There's no question in my mind that's what happened, that people took advantage of him. And they took advantage of my bike being there and knowing they could sell the parts.
Well, we just saw Ron Webb click off a fast pass. Here comes Mr. Mountain Magic, Elmer Trett, his lovely wife.
Danny Voak, right there.
Danny Voak. How about that? Oh, Team Vantine now, right?
Yep.
Shout out to Danny Voak. And again, look at all the guys that Scooter has around the track.
He's a young 71 or 2 now or something like that.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but nothing sounded quite like an Elmer Trett burnout.
No, he had his own sound back then.
Why was it so much deeper and meaner and ferocious?
He had the better fuel system. The guy was a fuel system genius back then.
At this point, you know, reading the book that Tom McCarthy put out and everything, was Elmer still taking grief from the Harley crowd that he switched over? Because there was such an intense rivalry between Harley and they would call the other bikes Jap bikes that say, you're a traitor, how dare you? That has since died down, we know, that motorcycles are motorcycles.
When it first happened, there was some going on. I mean, and that's just the way it was. But you know, the thing about it, none of them guys had the... we won't say the word, but they didn't have the gonads to say nothing to Elmer's face, I can tell you that.
Elmer was a tough dude, wasn't he?
Well, I can tell you right now, if he had to be knocked him out, I can tell you that much right now.
I read in Tom McCarthy's book, or you told me, that he could dunk a basketball.
And backwards.
That's crazy, because he was a big guy and he wasn't super tall.
Very agile, very, very.
Let's watch him in action here. Elmer blasting down the ATCO drag strip. What's he click off there? 665, and he shut it off early. He goes 181. He was down like 20 mile an hour from what you ran. Still ran a 665.
Right, and what happened on that pass? The thing actually lost the cylinder down there.
You can tell that from watching this VHS.
Oh, yeah, I could hear it.
You are a professor.
Yep, could hear it. So back then, we didn't know what was happening, but that's what it was. But we didn't have computers back then. You know, I mean, I think, you know, that might have been the year we went to computers. It might have been 1990. We might have had computers here. I'd have to look it back at some of my data, but I think it was 1989. You know, we went to a race pack when that thing was about as big as the TV we were watching this stuff on. You'd hardly have enough room to put them on the motorcycles. So we actually had the honor of putting Elmer's first computer on, so it was awesome. He brought it up to my shop, and we put it on. Actually, he came up to see ART, Jimmy Fox. And then when they got through down there at Gary's shop where Jimmy worked at, then of course he came up to my place and hung out for a couple of days, and we put the computer on and rolled old Mountain Magic out in the parking lot and cranked it up and did all the tests on the computer, and everything worked, and he loaded it back up and went to Demorest, Georgia.
So some people, especially old timers, were reluctant to accept technology. Did Elmer know that this is where the sport was going? This is what he had to do?
I was fortunate enough to get to run Elmer when he run Harley. So I had a Harley that I raced. So we traveled around together. Me, Elmer, and Jim McClure, we traveled together in vans. And it was all, you know, with Elmer, that was a race also. You had to race in the vans. I mean, it wasn't nothing to be running down the highway at 9,500 miles an hour. And then, you know, of course, then Elmer, you know, had that, his old van all hopped up, and then he'd make fun of us because we outrun us.
I could only imagine the stories.
It was a race going to the race.
I sure wish we had Cycledrag. Well, I guess we did in a way. We had Cycledrag cameras around. I wish we had the high-definition Cycledrag cameras around following you, Jim McClure, Elmer. I bet we would have got some great stories. Maybe some we couldn't even release, right?
Well, there's no question about that. But, you know, I was forced up to go to Elmer's shop in Ohio, too, you know. And, you know, he worked in a... it was the craziest garage I ever seen. It was underground. It was absolutely the most awesome thing that you'd ever seen. He'd just be down there working as a professor, and it was awesome.
I remember Jim McClure at this race. I went up, asked him for his autograph as a young boy, and let's just watch his greatness here for a second. Nice straight run. That's a straight run for a Nitro Harley today. 741, 186. But I remember asking Jim and talking to him, and he told me, he said, young man, he said, alcohol is for drinking, gas is for washing parts, nitro is for racing.
Absolutely. That was one of the things that Jim used to say a lot. A great ambassador of our sport.
He is sorely missed. He's another one that left way too soon, that's for sure. And what was it like hanging out with him? I know you guys would go over and bend an elbow or two after the races.
Well, we did that, but we got to race together in the dirt. You know, when I was just a kid, you know, starting out at 16, 17 years old, you know, I was racing Jim in the dirt. Jim was a big dirt racer at one time. And we came out, Jim, you know, Jim used to always run gas and outrun the fuel bikes. And we came out with a new fuel bike with a slipper clutch and a lot of nitro and won a bunch of races. And,
Rickey Gadson, by the way, we're taking a look at. He was Mr. New Jersey for a long time. You remember how many fans Rickey used to bring in? Remember when they bust his local neighborhood kids where he grew up in? Scooter would let them all in for free. This place, on a Friday, it just used to be packed.
And I believe the guy that was behind a lot of that was Wallace King.
Oh, wow.
So a lot of people don't remember him. But all you had to do was remember the gold.
All right. We want to talk about another legend? Here we go. There's a couple of them on the line. And guess who's adjusting the computer right now? The one and only Byron Hines. Byron used to come to the Prostar races back then. That's how big of a deal this was. Look at Dave, straight up and down, signature riding position. Straight as an arrow. 1991, ladies and gentlemen. 770, 169, Dave Schultz. Head of his time or what?
Way ahead of his time. And an excellent rider. He was a machine.
And there's, you guys want a little insight into Cycledrag. There's my dad's good buddy. His nickname was Mole, God bless him. And Scooter Kizer, if you're watching this, we apologize. We woke up super early, and he took me for a ride down the drag strip on his full dresser Harley. That was it, Larry. I was hooked after this. Oh, this is how I grew up.
That's what'll get you hooked right there.
I mean, I hope a lot of kids today get the opportunity. Look at me. I'm just happy as can be. We camped where the motocross track was. I want to thank that man because that, what an impact. I probably wouldn't be standing here with you right now telling these stories if it wasn't for him taking me for that ride and just the love that we had in our little pop-up camper, watching you guys, having fun. Check this out too. This is a funny story. So my dad, he no longer drinks. He used to be a drinker. He tries to cross the track. He didn't realize that you guys were doing track walk. So he's the only guy out there with a beer. And you guys are out. This is something you used to do where you used to walk the track to check it out pre-race.
Oh, yes.
I mean, wait till you see some of the legends we see out there. Freaking.
Andy Morocco just walked past just a second.
There's Ron Ayers. I think we saw Billy Vose a second ago. Is that Rickey Gadson? It might be Reggie Showers there. He was always there. My dad's just loving it. He's every bit as big of a fan as I am, that's for sure. I think even you were out there walking it.
It's early morning.
Early morning. We were already getting our spot in the grandstands.
This is probably 8, 9 o'clock in the morning.
I think you're right. That's what I guess I'm making my dad look bad for having a beer in his hand. He was on vacation, right?
Well, that's okay. Well, it was 5 o'clock somewhere.
That's right. And there is the man.
Elmer Trett.
Wow. Would Elmer enjoy going out there?
Oh, absolutely. I'm surprised I'm not walking right there with him. There's, I believe that's Jamie Morocco right there. I think so. I think it was.
Byron Hines? Good Lord. I think you're out there walking somewhere.
I'm walking. Got all my leathers on. That's why it's so cool. That's why you see everybody with their leathers on. It's pretty cool. And this is Monday morning.
Wow, that's right, because this race got carried over.
That's why I'm saying it's 8, 9 o'clock.
Ah.
I think we run like at 9:30 that morning.
This was the one my dad let me skip school to watch you on a Monday morning. How great was that?
Oh, it was awesome. That was just an awesome, I got an extra day out of work, so it was great.
And what I remember too, funny story about you guys, I'm a little boy, but I remember my dad and my godfather and all of our friends saying, boy, those McBride guys, they like to have fun at night. They like to party a little bit.
Well, yeah, back in them days we did, you know, and you know, the worst thing that I hated this, Ben, we got to have a hotel for another night, and this hotel's like $38 a night. Where are we going to get another $38 at, you know?
If you could only get the $38 rooms tonight, huh?
That's exactly right.
All right, so there's a good look at Greg Cope, Byron Hines, Dave Schultz. How close did Byron and Dave work together?
Oh, they worked really for a few years, you know, a couple of years. Byron went to all the races. You know, that was the Vance and Hines sponsored motorcycle right there. That's the only pro stocker they had.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like once Terry Vance walked away from the rider's position, Dave was really Byron's guy.
Absolutely. No question. Yep.
Let's watch the late, great Dave Schultz in action here. Beautiful motorcycle. Dave is sorely missed. Reggie Showers told me a wonderful story because he's talked about how Dave never drank, never partied. He said towards the end when Dave was going through chemotherapy, he showed up and Dave was drinking a margarita. And he said, if Dave's drinking a margarita, I know something's going on. And Dave had a big smile on his face and just told him, come on, let's enjoy life. And they knew it was getting close to the end.
Yeah, I tell you, it was a sad, sad thing.
Let's take a look at a couple fuel bikes here before we go. Happy Ring. We just saw Happy Ring down in Valdosta. How great was it to catch up with him?
Oh, it was great, man. He just quite wasn't as young as he was in this year. So
That's what I remember. This young guy was taking on all these Nitro Harley legends. Do we know who it is in the right-hand lane? In the black?
No, I don't know exactly who that is.
It's Happy. Not Bobby Spina, is it?
No, it's not Bobby Spina. Happy might be able to tell us who that is. So maybe if we make sure we tag him in this video.
Yeah.
I'm sure Happy Reed can tell us who that was.
We're definitely going to tag him in the video. This was what was cool about ATCO, too, is there were a lot of different places to watch from. I mean, look at this spectator turnout for a Monday. The amount of people that just blew off work and said, We're going to stay over another night.
McClure.
Jim McClure taking on, is that Bill Furr in the other lane?
Bill Furr.
Oh boy.
Southern Rock.
Oh God, what's your best Bill Furr story?
Oh, that we can tell. One? I can't even tell it. What are you talking about?
That's what I hear.
Southern Rock. Oh my gosh. Well, I guess one of the ones I could tell, I guess, is in probably back in 1986. We went up there and Bill Furr painted my bike.
Bill Furr painted your bike?
Yeah. Well, here's Larry Cutting, old boy that worked for him, painted it.
And we went out to the Southern Rock Cafe with adult beverages. And we finally got back to Orangeburg Cycle about 3 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, my God.
And Bill and I stayed the rest of the night in the shop, in the floor. So it was a lot of fun.
Wouldn't give nothing for them days.
We got another Spiderman rolling burnout.
Smoke that time, though.
Any chance you bring back the rolling burnout?
You know, probably not. Maybe, you don't know, but probably not. We kind of try to stick with what we do now.
Look at this one, Larry. Elmer Trett, Brian Johnson.
As you know, all the Europeans, mainly, you know, you've got a lot of Europeans that do the rolling burnout now.
Okay. When you look back 30 years later and you see these two late greats, what do you think of?
Think of all the good days. All the good days. Makes my heart sad for you, does.
Well, you know, I'm with you. But isn't it great that we got these VHSs?
Oh, there's no question about that.
And isn't it great that these guys made such an impact? Okay. I mean, you talk
there's
about...
Johnson walking up the side of the fence there.
And that's a beautiful story in and of itself.
That's when they were the only two that worked on that bike, two people.
They were inseparable.
Absolutely.
So much so that Ann passed away 1 hour before Brian's funeral.
Yep.
They went together.
Yep.
And I think that's the way they wanted it.
No question.
Gosh, I wish we had some TV-esque footage of these two guys. There is still some floating around out there. Scooter was good at bringing in TV when he could.
And I've got a bunch of tapes that Brian, when he retired, started taping all of the tapes. I've got a bunch of them tapes of a lot of the Prostar races. It almost felt Prostar.
Oh, cool.
I think I got all the way to pro, so it would...
All right, I can tell now. I think this might be the final round. You and Elmer advanced to the final. This looks like Dave Schultz versus... Is that the one and only Pizza John?
Pizza John, man. The best pizza in the world right there, buddy.
We got to call Del Flores to give us a Pizza John impression because I think he's got it spot on, right?
Oh, there's no question. Del Flores can absolutely... If you weren't looking at him, you would think it was Pizza John.
What do you remember about Pizza John? I mean, he won a championship. If you remember, he was an NHRA.
I think of Pizza John, I think of Del Flores.
Me too. He's totally ruined it.
Oh, yeah.
So Pizza John, an NHRA Pro Stock Motorcycle Champion, taking on Dave Schultz, the legend to be. Great race. We'll see if we can look through the sea of heads here. Dave getting there first. Look at that, 766, 177 in the year 1991. So amazing. Godspeed, Dave Schultz. We miss you. Pizza John goes 796 at 188. Looks like we have a Nitro Harley final. All right.
Ring, Bill Furr.
Happy Ring and Bill Furr. What do you think Bill Furr thought about taking on the young man, Happy Ring?
You know, Happy was a good guy, you know. We was fortunate enough to get to help Happy out. You know, we did some clutch work and a bunch of work at my shop for Happy and his father and back in them days. So it was a lot of fun, you know.
Sure.
It was great to see Happy in Ohio last year at Dragway 42.
And at the World Finals.
Yeah.
Valdosta, Georgia. We have not seen Bill Furr. We're going to have to get him back out to a race. Armin's still very active. Armin ran some NHRA races this year. And Armin said on Facebook he wants to get Southern Rock restored and get it in a motorcycle museum.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
It would be. All these bikes deserve to be enshrined. And I think coming up after this one, we may see two giants square off in Larry McBride and Elmer Trett.
I think we went
out
there.
Oh.
First smoke the tire.
Coming by though. Oh, Furr clips the rookie. 751. Oh, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, Larry, I'm sorry. Hold on. Let's guys, we got to tell you what happened here because I remember it well. This is what you call Murphy's Law. This is what you call Murphy's Law. The battery died. I remember my godfather was livid. That thing, thank goodness, you know, looking at it on the bright side, the battery stayed charged all weekend, but the battery died in the Top Fuel final and he could not get it back on. You can see it skips. I'll show you this one more time. Watch this. It skips. It skips three times because he tries to turn the camera on once, twice. But this is a run that I'm sorry we missed because this is one of the few times Larry beat Elmer. Sorry, Larry.
And I've got that run at home on a tape, or you might still have it here. I do still have that run on a VHS tape.
We got to find it. But to fill people in, you go 649, you break a record, you beat your mentor, Elmer Trett. How special was that one?
That was very special. And I tell you, Elmer was, he was happy for me and mad at me at the same time. So it was a great deal. But, you know, he congratulated me. He was a true champion.
He was, and he sorely missed. Well, thank you, Larry. What I told you this would be about 10 minutes ended up being closer to 50. So we better go to Supercross, but what a great trip down memory lane, huh?
Thank you, Jack.
You the man. Thanks. So we're going to make some more memories coming up, right?
Right on.
All right, man. Thanks so much.
Yes, sir.
Well, as promised, it was off to Supercross in beautiful Angel Stadium, but I really want to thank Larry for taking this trip down memory lane. If you have any stories involving these legends, please share.
You're 20-time Top Fuel champion. World record holder, and one thing I'd like to do would be thank cycledrag.com on Facebook, and I'd like for everybody to watch the and view Cycledrag on YouTube. People that help us out help our sport out a lot, and if you don't support them, hard for us to give any support, guys. And just keep supporting my man Jack, and we'll be here a long time.
I am George Price. I am very, very thankful for the cycledrag.com on Facebook and Cycledrag on YouTube. And I have been racing for a long time. I won a lot of races and had a lot of championships. And I'm very thankful for Cycledrag.com.
6 NHRA championships, 82 Wallys, and some fast baggers. Thank you very much, George Bryce. Do you like to watch at home on your phone?
I like to watch it on my phone no matter where I am, even on the airplane.
Thank you, George. Wait a minute, is it the legendary Jesse James? Are you really the legendary Jesse James?
Sometimes, only in my own mind.
What do you got on your hat?
Cycledrag.
You're the man. Do you watch the Cycledrag YouTube channel?
No, but you should.
We hope that you'll start watching, and I appreciate it.
Yep.
I hope you enjoyed this video. Please remember to subscribe to Cycledrag on YouTube, like cycledrag.com on Facebook, and we'll keep it coming. We are here to promote fast motorcycles all over the world. If you have any friends who you think may enjoy this, please refer them. They are always welcome. Thank you for the comments, the feedback. We appreciate it, guys. Thank you for subscribing to Cycledrag on YouTube.
Yes, thanks so much. I really hope you enjoyed this trip down memory lane, ATCO 91. It's near and dear to my heart. Again, if you have any stories, please share. And the best is yet to come. Larry Spiderman and McBride and I had a great time hanging out, and we hope to have more big news in the future, guys. If you want to follow along with all the latest, all you have to do is subscribe to Cycledrag on YouTube, like cycledrag.com on Facebook. If you have any friends who may enjoy this, share with them, and we'll keep it coming. We're keeping the history of motorcycle drag racing alive. Cycledrag rolls on.